see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world.
Very good evening to everyone. My name is Ed Nichols, and you will remember we've been bringing to you a series from the Dunstan Activity Centre Hub called Here and Now. And this is a listening service followed by some encouragements for us as a community to relate better to each other, hopefully, and to improve the quality of all our lives. Here and Now is this listening service which basically offers you the opportunity, if you need to talk yourself out and you can't really find anyone to listen compassionately to you. Sometimes it happens to us all, even if we have families and friends and workmates. Sometimes we just need to be able to get a lot of things off our chest, to talk it out, and to have a compassionate being listened to, for someone just to listen to what we say, not to kind of butt in or add any opinions, but just to give us a long listen to. So this service is basically for the Gateshead communities, and we can arrange to listen to you either by telephone. You can contact me on 0191 460 4567. If you work a telephone conversation, or I can hand you on to a woman who would listen to you, or you can email me if you want to speak by email, as a lot of people do these days. You can email me on ed.nichols, N-I-C-H-O-L-S, at live.com. And if you like to perhaps have a Zoom conversation, or even a COVID one-to-one, distanced and wearing face masks and things, then we can arrange that if you let me know, either by telephone or by email. But here's the important thing: if you need to talk, I want to encourage you to find an opportunity to do that. It's very important, particularly if you felt that you've needed to talk for a long time and you haven't been able to find anyone to listen to you. If you can find someone to listen to you, in your friends or your family or your work colleagues or whoever, I would encourage you to take full advantage of that. I would also encourage you to take full advantage of the services offered by your medical centres. We come in where sometimes you kind of get an immediate response. We don't take the place of what the medical centres offer, but we can give you an immediate response, and then later you can catch up with the services of your medical centre. And of course, you've got the Samaritans, which is a 24/7 helpline, which is an excellent service. So we are just a little addition to all of that for the Gateshead communities. So if you need to talk, let me encourage you very much to do that. If you feel, oh, I really need to talk this out. Do you know, sometimes we think that perhaps the problems of life are not are for people who are perhaps not so well off. I don't mean we're poor necessarily, but we're not rich. But I was just looking into the history of the royal family over generations, and so many of them had pretty tragic, if not miserable, lives. Even though they had basically anything that money could buy around them, they weren't happy. And do you know what was missing? Strangely enough, that within the family, the royal family, people didn't listen to them. They told them what they should do, what was expected of them, but actually, they didn't listen to what was on their hearts. And without getting into names and all the rest of it, what I realized was that for generations of royal of our royal family, they suffered just like the rest of us when they couldn't have an opportunity to talk out what was in their heart. And it seemed to me that in many cases, because of the busyness of the royal family, they basically just didn't have time or didn't think it was important enough to make time for. And without getting into all the details, again, even with our royal family, a lot of tragedies, simply because they didn't have people who they could talk to, people who would compassionately listen. And so we had a lot of broken-hearted royals, a lot of tragedies in our royal family. And so basically, it just shows you that it isn't just, if you like, ordinary people who need to be able to talk themselves out and have people listen to them compassionately. It's anybody. You could be a billionaire and still need it. And without it, whether you're a member of the royal family or an ordinary person, whether you're a millionaire or whether you're just a person getting by, we're all the same. We have a lot in common. You cut us and we bleed, all of us. And basically, unless we can talk the things off our chest to someone who will listen to us, that will cause our lives to be quite sad and ultimately even quite tragic. So I just want to encourage you in that. I noticed that very sadly, as I say, as I studied our royal family and realized what was missing there. It was fairly simple. Not money, not special services, not all that money could buy, not holidays, or anything technological that you would desire. Nothing like that caused the unhappiness. Very simple things. They needed to talk and to be listened to, and they couldn't find it. So let me encourage you. You and I are not royalty as such, but we're very important, and you're very important. And basically, I want to encourage you to understand that we need to be listened to when we have things on our heart that we need to say. So let us all just see the importance of these things. Did you listen to that Louis Armstrong song, What a Wonderful World? I would like to encourage you also, if you're going through a fairly low time, just to consider a few things that might be helpful. I love that song of Louis Armstrong's. It's a very simple song, isn't it? The lyrics are simple. But it says, you know, it makes much of little things that you and I experience in life. And it's a happy little song. And I think it went to the top of the charts in this country and abroad. And it's always being played. So it seems to have a message for us. So if you're ever in a low mood and you feel, oh, you're on your own and nothing's going well for you, life's hardly worth living and things, let me encourage you, as well as seeking to find someone to listen to you, just to perhaps think of some things that might be helpful. Look at this graphic here. Here's a woman who is grateful, and she's basically got this card saying, thank you. Can I just say, you know, sometimes, I don't know about you, but sometimes if I'm in a bit of a grumpy mood, you know, I didn't sleep very well, I'm tired and everything's not quite going my way, or I don't feel very good. Sometimes what it does, it closes my eyes and my ears to all the things that I really need to be grateful for. Do you know what helps my low mood is if I find things to be thankful for? And you know, there's so many things to be thankful for. I don't know about you, but I like to feed the birds in the morning, particularly in the snowy mornings, because, you know, these little robins in the garden, blackbirds, magpies, wood pigeons, and so on. These little birds, obviously, they're hungry. And it's quite hard, you know, when there's 6 inches of snow to find anything. So I love feeding them. But then I love when I throw all the food out for them, just to get a glimpse of them coming to eat. And they always make me smile. And I always think British birds are quite beautiful. And again, you know, you might think this is all very romantic, but actually it's not. You know, it's just part of normal life, isn't it? Feed the birds. If you're ever in a low mood, start feeding the birds. It will change your perspective. When you feed them, you'll be looking to see them feed. And when you look at them, you know, they seem as though they don't get into low moods like we humans, do they? These wild creatures just seem to basically get on with it. And when we look at them, you know, we love the robin in this country, don't we? You love the red breast, and we love the fact that when the snow is out, you can really see these robins very clearly, particularly with this distinctive red breast. And also that they're just quite chirpy creatures, aren't they? They're quite, they're kind of dart around a lot, but they're quite chirpy, and they just seem as though nothing defeats them. So, you know, I want to encourage you, you know, if you just want to be grateful for little things, consider feeding the birds. And then, and just watch them feeding because you bothered to provide some food. Cheers me up, and I think it can cheer us all up, you know, just looking at things, you know. Looking some days, you know, at the sky. You know, again, you know, sometimes the winter skies are beautiful. Some of these winter mornings are quite beautiful. Have a walk. There's lots of walks around Gateshead, you know, where you can just get out and then you appreciate things that are out there. You see how the snow kind of, you know, brings a stillness everywhere and how it beautifies everything. And it's good to do these things. And then you feel a sense of gratefulness about being alive. And grateful people, you know, they often come very quickly out of low moods. Or if they feel hopeless and helpless and they want their life to change but they don't know how. You know, it can be changed by little things, by being a grateful person, a thankful person. And when you think about it, I wonder sometimes, you know, if you would just think of the things that you can be grateful for. It might be just that you've got beautiful, cold drinking water. I love the drinking water up north. And I like it cold. And it's clean, of course, as well. You know, we mightn't think, well, that's much. What's that to be grateful for? I tell you what, in the third world, they would be dancing for joy if they had that. Something cool, clear, and healthy to drink. Learn to be grateful, to be able to say thank you for things, to say thank you for people who are kind. You know, I tell you what I like, you know, sometimes I go to Aldi's, you know, and I've got usually about, you know, just a couple of things, you know, and people in front of me have got, you know, trolleys full of stuff, you know, I think, oh goodness me, I'm going to be here for an hour. But what I love is they say, go on, you go off, you before me, you've only got a couple of things. It's kind, isn't it? It's thoughtful. They could say, oh, the pot. They could not even notice me and just say, oh, the pot, I'll just, me first, I was here first. But they don't. And I'm always touched by that, that people are kind. There's a lot of kindness around, you know, just in all these, you know. And sometimes there's been three people with trolleys and I've had, say, like a bunch of flowers for somebody or something, or a packet of biscuits for my wife that I forgot to get. And three people with trolleys full of items will just say, go on, you go first. You know, and these things we should appreciate. I always try to say a big thank you to them and say, thank you, that was thoughtful. And that gives me an opportunity to just to cheer them up as well. But there's so much around us to be thankful for. I want to encourage you just to try to think. You know, you get up in the morning and you've got a fire on, or you've got heating, or you've got a shower that's warm, or a bath that's warm, or, you know, these things we can be grateful for. You might think, oh, this is all stupid, but I don't think it is. I think it's only stupid when we take these things for granted. And it's good to be a thankful person, because a thankful person will be helped by their gratitude to see life positively and to come out from low moods. It helps. So if anybody does you a kindness, or, you know, or you see something that makes you smile, I want to encourage you to be grateful for it. Look at this next graphic here. I want to encourage you to look at these words here. And what it says basically is this. It says that appreciate the people who fill the spaces in your life for one day, when you least expect it, because without them, those spaces will be empty. Do you know, there's lots of things that can fill the spaces in your life. You know, you might say, well, I don't have a lot of friends, you know, and I don't know a lot of people. And of course, that can be true, and that's quite sad. But I think rather than just settle for that, let's just notice the people who come across in our lives. You know, if you're standing at a bus stop, either begin a conversation or be grateful if someone did begin the conversation. You know, when a person speaks to you or you speak to them, it says two things. It says, first of all, I noticed you. You're not just like a bus shelter. You're a human being. I noticed you. And I think you are special enough to start a conversation with. It might be something, you know, pretty ordinary, like, bye, it's freezing or something. But, you know, it's good. Because these people who we, only for perhaps a couple of minutes, they are filling the spaces in our lives. I'd like you to keep this concept of people and things filling the spaces in your life. Because without these things filling the spaces, our life can be empty. The spaces are empty. But these people and these things that happen to us fill the spaces. And it can be all kinds of things. Once you get into this way of thinking, this positive way of thinking, then basically we come out of low moods. And a lot of people are in low moods. And I can understand why, you know, people who've become redundant, lost their jobs, they're not sure if they're ever going to get a job. They're wondering about whether benefits is going to be enough. They're wondering about their children, their wives, their husbands, their partners, their futures, you know, things like this. Will they ever have a holiday abroad again? Stuff, all kinds of stuff. But basically, can you see that the more that we become aware of the people and the things that fill our spaces, the spaces in our life, even for a short while, the more life seems to be a much happier experience for us. You know, a postman, you know, knocks on the door with a parcel. Or, you know, your window cleaner comes, you know, and you just have a couple of words with him, go out and have a couple of words with him. Just the things, you know, just creatures, you know, notice dogs and things. You know, often you see these dogs walking around and all shapes and sizes. And, you know, some of them are really quite funny. I saw a dog outside of my house today, a black dog, looked like a bit of a poodle. And the owner was walking along with it, and this dog decided that it loved the snow and it started rubbing its face in the snow. It was walking and rubbing its face in the snow as it went. And I've never seen a dog do that before. I've seen them rolling around it. I've never seen one walking along, rubbing its face in as it went, you know. And it just made me smile. And, you know, these things may seem, you know, I don't know if these things seem a little foolish to you, but I'm just trying to say to you, these things fill the spaces in my life. When I saw this happening, I was just standing there outside my home. I'd just come in, and I had a little space, and this dog, you know, made me smile, you know, as I watched it, and I thought, oh, it really likes the snow, this dog, you know. And it just cheers us up with positive things. So can I encourage you just to look around you, particularly when you're feeling a bit alone or a bit low, and just notice the things around you that might fill the space. It might be just up in the sky. It might be just a holly bush in somebody's garden that's got beautiful red berries on it. You know, these things can affect us. I think that's what Louis Armstrong's song is about, that little things fill the spaces in our lives. And they are part of what he calls a wonderful world. Look at this next graphic here. I love this graphic because it reminds me when I was in Uganda last year. And I was in a third world place called Michana. And in Michana, there's such poverty. And why I like this photograph here is because, do you know, what really refreshed me out there was to see these children, often very poor, smiling. If I'm really honest with you, I saw more smiling in that third world place in the villages from the children, the adults, though honestly, they had nothing. And I mean nothing. Some of these little girls I saw one little girl, she had a yellow dress on. I don't know the last time it was washed, but or the last time she even took it off, but she had this little yellow dress. She'd be a girl about 7. And you know, she was dancing along beside the motorway as if she was the richest little girl in the world, smiling, happy, seemed to have nothing. And I noticed that they had never forgotten to smile. And often we have forgotten to smile. We've forgotten to smile. Apparently, in certain parts of the world, you will find that people who are African of origin tend to be happier and to smile more and to laugh more. And these things, if you see a smiling child, basically they can be those people who, just for a little while, fill the spaces in your life. And it can be just simple things, you know, a smiling child, you know, something like that, that just it fills the spaces in our lives. I want to encourage you to look for them. When I saw these smiling children in the villages, in these third world villages, honestly, it just cheered me up. And I thought, my goodness me, they've got nothing. And they look happier than a lot of British children. And then I realized it's just an attitude. They woke up cheerful. They expected life to be cheerful and good, it seemed to me. They weren't thinking about what they didn't have. They were appreciating what they did have. And don't you think that will help us all, you know, just to come out of ourselves and to start appreciating life more and keeping out of low moods. When we get into low moods, goodness me, isn't that an awful way? I've been in them. It's terrible, I find. You know, when your thoughts go down the tubes and you go with them, it's awful. But then there's so much for us to look around and observe and to be cheered up by. I want to encourage you to do that. Look at this next graphic here. I know we're not all extroverts, some of us are introverts, and I know we're not all very, you know, outwardly sociable. A lot of us are quite shy. But, you know, it's good to enjoy people that you meet and to cultivate the habit of being friendly towards people. Do you know, this shaking a hand, you know, I think in the song that Louis Armstrong sang at the beginning, he says, you know, that people who shake hands, they're really saying, I love you. And I don't think that's corny. You know, I like to shake hands with people. And basically, it's a good thing to do. It's an exchange of affection, isn't it? When you know, if you meet somebody and you shake hands with them, you don't have to. You know, a lot of us are in the habit of not doing it, you know, just saying hello or hi or whatever. But to shake hands, I think, is an expression of friendliness, which is a genuine exchange between two people. Now, obviously, we can't go shaking hands just with everybody, you know, complete strangers and things, unless we get a genuine opportunity to meet them. But if we're reduced or we're in a situation, just say, it's nice to meet you, or, you know, thank you for your kindness, it's good to shake hands. Apparently, in little villages, you know, where community was strong, that those kind of things people did, they would say good morning if they saw people. They would talk, always talk. They would never stand at a bus stop quiet, not speaking to each other. They would always speak. And if they met somebody for the first time, they would shake hands. I want to encourage you to fill your spaces with things like this, with positive attitudes towards other people. At the beginning, I said, you know, if you need a good talking out, then I've given you the contact details and reminded you of the other agencies that exist. May I say to you, Obviously, if you need to talk yourself out, it's probably been happening for a long time. But don't be discouraged. You look for the opportunity. I'm sure you'll get it. And that will help you. It will help you to realize that life is good and can be really good for you and for me again if we've kind of lost our way a bit. And just see if you can look around you and let what you see and the people you meet and the laughter you hear and the smiles you see and the birds who feed on the food you put in your garden cheer you up and cheer me up. I think our communities will really prosper when we are, generally speaking, happy. Happier than we are. Perhaps we all need to go to a third world village to realise how little they have and yet how happy you can be with little. But I doubt whether that's possible for us all. Anyway, I hope these things are helpful to us all. That our communities, instead of talking about, oh, communities used to be great, you know, everybody liked each other, knew each other, helped each other, instead of talking about it, by these little things, I believe we build community again and make it good and better than it's ever been. We don't just want what was, we want something better than it has ever been. And incidentally, people say about Northeastern community life that it was good when people had nothing. And often today we think, oh, if we haven't got a lot of money or a lot of material possessions or this or that, then we can't be really happy. But actually, as with the third world, so these rather poor communities in Gateshead and Newcastle and the Northeast prove to us that yes, you can be. And often when you've got nothing, that's the happiest you've ever been. Now, I don't want us to have nothing, but let's see if we can't all play our part in just causing our communities to be caring places where we notice each other, where we celebrate one another, even in small ways, and where we all learn this wonderful art of listening to others as well as talking. I really thank you for your time. I'm going to leave you with Louis Armstrong again, and I hope the song cheers you up. Thanks for your time. Bye-bye.
I see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. I see skies of blue and clouds of white, the bright blessed day, the dark sacred night. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. The colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky, are also on the faces of people going by. I see friends shaking hands, saying, how do you do? They're really saying, I love you. I hear babies cry. Them grow, they learn much more than I never knew. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. Yes, I think to myself, what a wonderful world.